مَن يَقْنُتْ مِنكُنَّ لِلَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ وَتَعْمَلْ صَالِحًا نُؤْتِهَا أَجْرَهَا مَرَّتَيْنِ وَأَعْتَدْنَا لَهَا رِزْقًا كَرِيمًا
مَن يَقْنُتْ مِنكُنَّ لِلَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ وَتَعْمَلْ صَالِحًا نؤتها أجرها مرتين وأعتدنا لها رزقا كريما.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. All praise be to Allah Almighty and peace be upon His beloved Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. Brothers and sisters, dear viewers, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. And I welcome you again into this new series, Pioneer Women in Islam. These pioneer women, these great women in Islam that our history is full of, these great women in Islam that are role models and examples for every single person, for every single man and woman. These pioneer women in Islam that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed them to sacrifice for His religion and to sacrifice for His deen. Sometimes, my brothers and sisters, we say to ourselves, why does Allah ask us to sacrifice for Him when He does not need it? Why does Allah Azza wa Jal ask us to pray for Him when he does not need our prayers? Why does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ask us to donate for His sake when He does not need our money? He is the Lord and He is the Master and He is the one that described Himself the rich one. And He is the one that described Himself as Samad, the one who is independent and everyone depends on Him. So why does Allah ask us to do those things? To honor us. This is the simple answer. To honor us. To honor us by doing something that pleases Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In return, He will be pleased from us and then He'll enter us the paradise. This is an honor from Allah to us. Allah does not need our worships. Allah does not need our sacrifices. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not need our donations. Allah does not need our salah. Allah does not need our fasting. Then why does Allah command us? To honor us. To honor us with His worship. To honor us with the prayers. To honor us with the fasting. To honor us with the donation. To honor us in the hereafter with the paradise. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands us to do that. And Allah azza wa jal had sent examples. These great examples from the prophets and the messengers. And their disciples and companions. And amongst those are great women in Islam that we are talking about in this series. So we could know that Islam is not just about men, but Islam is also about women. Islam did not spread because of the men. Islam spread to the east and the west because of also the women. Islam was not only upheld by the men, but was also upheld by the women. Islam did not come to us just because of the men, but also because of the women. Many of the narrations of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam that we know of him are narrated by female companions of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and in particular his wives, in particular Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha. So many narrations in the thousands. If it wasn't for them, we would not know a lot of Islam. So that some scholars say, if it wasn't for the narrations of the mothers of the believers, if it wasn't for the narrations that the wives of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam narrated to us, half of Islam we would not even know about it. Islam is about men and women. Islam is about females and males. Islam is about the two, both of them, put hand to hand and continue upholding the deen of Allah Azza wa Jal. And today, inshaAllah, we want to talk about an amazing companion. Not only that she was a companion of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, but she was also from the family of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasallam and the daughter of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, Zainab. Zainab is the elderly daughter of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. She's the eldest of his family, sallallahu alayhi wasalam, of his children. Zainab radiallahu ta'ala anha, the eldest daughter of the Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam. The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam had 6 children from Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha. He had Al-Qasim, he had Abdullah, and then he had 4 girls. The eldest one is Zainab, then Ruqayya, then Kulthum, and the last one is the lover of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, Fatima al-Zahra, the rose of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Zainab was the elderly one. And when we say the elderly one, you could imagine the connection of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam to Zainab. You could imagine the care of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam to Zainab. Zainab was the eldest daughter of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and she was born 10 years before the prophecy. So she was born 10 years before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent his revelation to Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam, which makes the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam 30 years when Allah Almighty blessed him with Zainab. And Zainab radiallahu ta'ala anha got married to Abu al-As ibn al-Rabi', who is the cousin of Zainab radiallahu ta'ala anha. And from Abu al-As, she had two children, Ali and Umama. She had two children, Ali and Umama. But Ali passed away in an early stage. And Abu al-As was the son-in-law of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And Zainab is the daughter of the Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasallam. And the family and the household of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasallam were to be the first to embrace Islam. When the Prophet alayhi salatu wasallam called to Islam, his wife and his daughters and the close ones to him did not hesitate to follow the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, because they know this man does not lie. He does not lie on a human being. He's not going to lie on the Lord of human beings. They know that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam does not lie or cheat. So Muhammad never lied and never cheated on anyone. How is he going to lie and cheat on Allah Almighty? So when Zainab heard her father calling to Allah, and she was only 10 years old, she also became a Muslim. She followed the path of her father, even though she was married when she was young, radiallahu ta'ala anha. And she started to order her husband Abu al-As to embrace Islam. But Abu al-As, he knows who Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam is. He is the son-in-law of Muhammad alayhi salatu wasallam. And he knows that this man does not lie or deceive. But he was worried and afraid, what would his people say about him? He was worried and afraid what his tribe will react towards him. That's why Abu al-As, deep inside, he knew that Muhammad is saying the truth, but he did not follow the path of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam till even later. He delayed his Islam till even after the migration. And Zainab, she was so sad and grieved that she loved Abu al-As. And Abu al-As loved Zainab. He's not going to get someone greater than the daughter of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. But he was worried and afraid about his tribe. And in one of the battles, the Battle of Badr, Abu al-As was fighting with the non-believers against the Muslims. And Abu al-As was captured. Abu al-As was captured to be a prisoner of war in the hands of the Muslims. And when the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam and the Muslims were victorious in the Battle of Badr, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed them with victory. They also had prisoners of war, 70 of them. And the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he said that these prisoners of war can be ransomed by their families in a certain amount of money, and whoever does not have money, they teach 10 Muslims how to read Arabic, and then that's a ransom, and that's a ransom and for them to be free. Zainab was still in Mecca. She was still the wife of Abu al-As, and she was still in Mecca. When she heard about the capturing of her husband Abu al-As, and she heard that her father Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam is accepting ransom, so Zainab sent to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam a necklace that she had from her mother as a ransom for her husband Abu al-As. When the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam saw the necklace, and he recognized the necklace that belongs to Khadija, his wife, the mother of Zainab, and he recognized that this necklace is for Zainab, and he knew that Zainab is trying to free her husband Abu al-As, the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam started to cry and weep, sympathizing to his daughter Zainab. It's his elderly daughter, and she is the wife of Abu al-As, and his daughter is stuck in Mecca, and she is deprived from being with her father, and she is under persecution alone, just being away from her father in Mecca amongst the non-believers. So the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam told the companions, would you free this man for my daughter, Abu al-As? Would you free this man for my daughter? So the companion said, O Messenger of Allah, whatever you decide on, we agree. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam, from his character, in Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam, from his morals, he's the leader. He could have said, that's it, you are free. But he wants to consult his companions. So no one feels that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam favors his son-in-law over the rest. So Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam consulted, would you free this man Abu al-As and let him go to my daughter Zainab? Would you let him free and let this necklace go back to Zainab? It belongs to her mother. So the companions, with all respect, said, "Oh, Messenger of Allah, we free who you free. And we decide on what you decide." So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala let Abu al-As free and go back to Zainab, his daughter, with the necklace. But Abu al-As yet still hesitant to become a Muslim. He's still hesitant to embrace Islam. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded the believing woman not to stay with non-believing men. Allah commanded the believing woman not to stay with their non-believing husbands. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent that law, and the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam later on sent a companion to pick up Zainab from Mecca and to bring Zainab to him in Medina. And the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam excused Abu al-As and said, "I want my daughter." And Abu al-As could not say no. He has tremendous respect to his father-in-law, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. But at the same time, he's hesitant to embrace Islam. And on the way of her journey, radiallahu ta'ala anha, she was leaving Mecca to come to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And on the way, Zainab radiallahu ta'ala anha will be attacked by one of the enemies of the people of Quraysh while she is on her mount, and she fell from her camel, and she was pregnant and she had miscarriage. And then she went back to Mecca because she was bleeding and she was injured. And then later on, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam sent another man to pick her up, Zayd ibn Haritha radiallahu ta'ala anhu, to bring her to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And it was later on that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted that moment for Zainab to unite with the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasallam finally unites with his daughter Zainab. But Zainab is still attached to Abu al-As. And Abu al-As still attached to Zainab. And Abu al-As still hesitant to embrace Islam. So one day on his journey, on a business journey, he was captured by the believers. And Abu al-As was brought forward to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam with all his caravans and money. So the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam looked at Abu al-As and he told him, "Isn't it that time for you to come to Islam?" And Abu al-As, deep inside, he knows that what Muhammad is calling for is the truth. He knows what the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam is calling for is the haqq. So Abu al-As, he said, "Oh Muhammad, free me and let me go, and everything that you took from me, let me go." So Abu al-As was freed by the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam after he consulted the companions. He was free to go, him and his entire caravan. So he went back to Mecca and gave all the belongings to the people of Quraysh from his caravan, and then ran back to Medina to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam and embraced Islam and said, "Oh Messenger of Allah, ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa anna Muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluh." So the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam was so happy to see that his son-in-law Abu al-As is now a Muslim, and not only that, he sallallahu alayhi wasallam accepted Zainab to go back to him on the original marriage contract, and they lived together. But unfortunately, Zainab radiallahu ta'ala anha did not live for long to see more of the Islam spreading, to see the opening of the conquest of Mecca. So Zainab radiallahu ta'ala anha passed away the 8th year of Hijrah, just a few years after she migrated from Mecca to Medina, alongside by her father. And the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam was so upset and sad to the death of his elderly daughter Zainab. And Zainab radiallahu ta'ala anha was that woman, that one of the only daughters and the only daughter that died out of an injury for the sake of Allah. She died because of the injury she had when one of the disbelievers of Quraysh attacked her. She died because of that injury. And the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he says, "She is the only one that was injured for me. She was the only one that was injured for me, for Islam." Zainab radiallahu ta'ala anha. Zainab, the daughter of Muhammad. Zainab, the daughter of Khadija. Zainab, the elderly daughter of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. She passed away the 8th year of the Hijrah, and she was buried in Al-Baqi' radiallahu ta'ala anha wa ardaha. Be with us insha'Allah on more other great women, other great companions from the pioneer woman in Islam. Insha'Allah, stay with us with other episodes. I'll leave you in the care of Allah. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
لله ورسوله وتعمل صالحا نؤتها أجرها مرتين وأعتدنا لها رزقا كريما
يقنت منكن لله ورسوله وتعمل صالحا نؤتها أجرها مرتين وأعتدنا لها رزقا كريما
كن لله ورسوله وتعمل صالحا نؤتها أجرها مرتين وأعتدنا لها رزقا كريما.
What does Allah command us? To honor us with His worship, to honor us with His with the prayers, to honor us with the fasting, to honor us with the donation, to honor us in the hereafter with the paradise. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands us to do that. And Allah azza wa jal had sent examples, these great examples from the prophets and the messengers and their disciples and companions. And amongst those are great women in Islam that we are talking about in this series. So we could know that Islam is not just about men, but Islam is also about women. Islam did not spread because of the men. Islam spread to the east and the west because of also the women.
نؤتها أجرها مرتين وأعتدنا لها رزقا كريما.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. All praise be to Allah Almighty and peace be upon His beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Brothers and sisters, dear viewers, assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. And I welcome you again into this new series, Pioneer Women in Islam. These pioneer women, these great women in Islam.
يقنت منكن لله ورسوله وتعمل صالحا نؤتها أجرها مرتين وأعتدنا لها رزقا كريما
يقنت منكن لله ورسوله وتعمل صالحا نؤتها أجرها مرتين.
He is the master, and he is the one that described himself the rich one, and he is the one that described himself as Samad, the one who is independent and everyone depends on him. So why does Allah ask us to do those things? To honor us. This is the simple answer. To honor us. To honor us by doing something that pleases Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In return, He will be pleased from us, and then He'll enter us the paradise. This is an honor from Allah to us. Allah does not need our worships. Allah does not need our sacrifices. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not need our donations. Allah does not need our salah. Allah does not need our fasting. Then why Islam, that our history is full of these great women in Islam that are role models and examples for every single person, for every single man and woman. These pioneer women in Islam that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed them to sacrifice for His religion and to sacrifice for His deen. Sometimes my brothers and sisters, we say to ourselves, why does Allah ask us to sacrifice for Him when He does not need it? Why does Allah Azza wa Jal ask us to pray for Him when He does not need our prayers? Why does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ask us to donate for His sake when He does not need our money? He is the Lord.